studio 10. Now, Prince Charles and Camilla, are they heading down under for a royal tour next month? But have you ever wondered what the royals are really like? Well, entertainment reporter Craig Bennett sat down with someone who's met most of the royal family.
The bigger the napkin, the better.
She's the master of good manners, and boy, does she have a tough lesson for me.
If you had asparagus on your plate, how would you eat it?
Pick it up.
Yes.
And eat it like that.
Yes, and then afterwards, what would you do?
Pick up the next one.
At the end of the dish.
Oh!
Now, if you had an artichoke...
I'm terrified.
What would you do with the artichoke?
I'm not good on artichokes. I'm not going to use it as a doorstop.
No, no, you're going to eat it.
But who is this etiquette queen? Well, here's a reminder.
Beautifully made. Ooh, and even turns over with one twist of the wrist.
And who could forget these very famous catchphrases?
Is it safe and does it come in other colours?
You're a low rat, Ron. You really are a low rat.
You live with a badge and that's
you know
all you've got.
That is?
And then what
do you
is
know
that?
What that is?
What is it? What is
it? How did you feel? I mean, you really did save the day, didn't you?
One got up and one gave one a push and the next one was about to sock somebody. And our darling compere, Ray Martin, I was waiting for him to say, boys, stop. But they didn't, so I was about to get out of my chair, which I did, and it was saying to them, stop it. I felt terrible. I didn't like it. And when we went to leave, you know, the press were outside and what are you going to say? I said, nothing.
But before Diana Fisher became one of Australia's most loved TV personalities, she was making a name for herself in London as a magician's assistant.
I disappeared. I was stuck on spears. I was never sawn in half. That was somebody else.
Is that your big regret in life, though, not having been sawn in half?
No, no.
Oh, Diana.
And I don't know how it's done.
Are you sure?
Absolutely.
You're not fibbing to me now,
no,
are
I'm
you?
Not. I know how I was done. I mean, as you might say. I joined the BBC, I was in the BBC reviews, I sang and danced with. If it was today, it would be Peter Overton I'd be singing and dancing with because I had the guy from BBC who was an absolute stunner. And progressed into eventually researching royal weddings, royal occasions, and then television and broadcasting. I sort of swapped shoes later on from doing all the research. I became the commentator.
At one point, though, you were working with, what, 102 commentators in 53 countries?
They all came to Prince Charles's investiture at Carnarvon, and that was one of my arguments with Buckingham Palace. I had two with them. They wanted to give him a circlet of gold, and I said, no. You can enthrone a prince with a circlet of gold, but if you crown someone Prince of Wales, he must have a crown. So they had to make this lovely, very modern crown, which Louis Osmond did.
What about parties at Buckingham Palace? Have you been inside Buckingham Palace and rubbed shoulders with the royals?
Yes, I have. I've always loved Prince Charles because he never stops asking questions. He's just lovely, and when we were on a royal tour, you once asked me if I was friends with any of them. You don't become friends, but you do get to be remembered.
How do you think he is with Camilla? I mean, are they a match?
Fantastic.
Lady? Why is that,
They've
Diana?
Got a terrific sense of humour, and if she isn't there, he's looking for her. If you go to dinner, he's waiting for her to come. And they just get on like a house on fire. And she actually, if you think about it, doesn't say anything that's wrong and hasn't put a foot wrong.
Diana, Princess of Wales, has died after a car crash in Paris.
Was the death of Diana a huge shock to you?
Oh, awful. I can remember it vividly, and I also can remember that thinking something was going to happen somewhere because she was basically running wild and, I dare not say, out of control.
So you had a premonition at some point something would happen?
No, I knew something had to happen, and I knew basically that the love affair was over with Jodie and she was going to come back, and it was going to be over, but he wanted to show her where he lived in France, and if they hadn't gone, she was going home, but he said, come and look at this, to see, I suppose, if he could persuade her. But no, sad, very, very sad.
What about Queen Elizabeth? Have you met her?
I have. She's a delight. You know, when she's not on duty, is a wonderful mimic. And the Queen did a wonderful takeoff of somebody going across the lawn in high-heeled shoes, getting sort of stuck, you know, how you would. Lovely. Lovely lady.
wonderful.
When you've been in Buckingham Palace or maybe on the Royal Yacht Britannia, do you ever get a little cheeky and maybe have a snoop around?
That's right. On Britannia, I said, could you please show me where the bathroom is or whatever, the heads? And I was taken and I was brought back.
And Diana ended up marrying her own Prince Charming, the Archbishop of Canterbury's son, Humphrey Fisher.
He asked me out to dinner. So I thought, might as well. Having had an unhappy love affair, I thought, well, I might as well try somebody else. Anyway, we went out for quite a while and I was flying backwards and forwards and we went on holidays together and eventually he did ask me to marry him. And shan't tell you how, when and where, but I shall say, I said no. And he persisted and he was there with the flowers. He was there to take me to opening nights. And he was a darling, a highly intelligent and clever man. And of course, in the end, he won. And of course, we got married at Lambeth Palace by father, lovely. And 22nd of July, 1959, and I don't suppose you were born.
I wasn't, Diana, no. Not far off it, though, I hasten to add.
Gosh, it makes me sound old.
I almost could have been there, you know. Almost.
Darling, thank you for coming.
What an absolute joy to catch up.
Cheers.
It's been way too long.
It has.
Cheers, is this how we do it?
No.